Volkswagen's not really known for their EVs, and this is their 2024 ID.4 Pro S. And I mean, lately we've been driving their Golf R, GTI, and Jetta GLI, and I'm wondering if a traditional automaker can crack the EV code. What's this like? Let's go for a drive. I'm your host, Brian Max, racer, lover of driving fast, fun things. And on this channel, you get reviews for drivers from drivers. Now, this is something all new from Volkswagen. This is definitely a different direction. It's a pure EV. And I've been a Volkswagen GTI enthusiast for a very long time. So it's very interesting to see Volkswagen going in this direction. And before we get into what this is like to drive, let's have a look at it in a little more depth. One of the best parts about driving an EV is that you don't have to bother going to gas stations. It's one of those things that I forget about until I drive an EV again, and it's awesome not having to go to a gas station. I've heard some people say that the design is a bit bland, but I actually find it quite interesting, and definitely with this paint color, it's a very attractive crossover. Sure, it looks like a Volkswagen crossover, but rest assured, this is a pure EV. Since this is the all-wheel drive model, there are two electric motors, one at the front, one at the rear. They make combined 335 horsepower and 320 pounds of torque. The battery is a 77 kilowatt hour size. The range of this ID.4 Pro S is 263 miles or 423 kilometers, and maximum charge rate, the DC fast charging, is 170 kilowatts. Steering is electrically assisted, of course. Suspension is based around McPherson struts at the front, multi-link at the rear with conventional dampers. This one's rolling on some 21s and actually look pretty good. Towing capacity of this ID.4 Pro S is 2,700 pounds, and curb weight of this one is a little over 4,900 pounds.
Did you know that about 80% of you are not subscribed? Yes, it's true. I checked the data and 80% of you are not subscribed. So if you enjoy the content on this channel, do me a solid, hit that subscribe button while you're at it. Be sure to like this video and share it. And if you don't mind, drop by our merch store. There's lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, including our very popular line of Save the Manuals merch. Now back to your regularly scheduled episode.
Behind the wheel, we've got a completely different experience from all the other modern Volkswagens we've driven lately. Because this is an EV, they took the opportunity to make this a little bit more tech forward than the traditional cars in Volkswagen's lineup. For example, there's a very compact instrument cluster, which I actually don't mind. And then, of course, we've got the big iPad on the dash, which we'll talk about in a little bit. But in terms of the fundamentals, once you're seated here behind the wheel, you've got great visibility because of course, you've got a crossover-like seating position. The steering wheel has a traditional Volkswagen shape with the flat bottom nonsense at the bottom of the wheel. Otherwise, it encourages you to have your hands at 9 and 3, and all of these secondary controls are all touch-based. And after a lot of time, I did get accustomed to these. Not really a fan of them in the GTI, Golf R, and Jetta GLI we drove recently, but I've gotten used to these simply because I've been spending a bit of time behind the wheel here. The seat is pretty generous. It's bolstered as it should be in a crossover that's not performance oriented. It's heated and cooled at this trim level, and overall it's very comfortable, very supportive even over longer distances. There's plenty of adjustment in the seat and the steering column to get a very comfortable and appropriate seating position, and this seat has a lot of adjustment rearward, so you can probably be 8 feet tall and still sit behind the wheel here. And I'm not joking, I can set this seat so far back that I can't even reach the pedals. They've taken the opportunity with the EV platform to maximize storage, and there's plenty of room for your stuff all throughout this front row. Second row is very generous in terms of space, though if you're taller, you can really crush the person behind you. But in my seating position, anybody seated behind me when I'm in this seating position is going to have a ton of room in that second row. There's a lot of space and a decent amount of room under the hatch as well. Now, I do want to talk about this infotainment system. This is definitely new school Volkswagen. It works pretty well. It's a very simple, straightforward system. I use it on Apple CarPlay. It's available wired or wirelessly. But the one thing I got to talk about are these controls that we saw in the GTI Golf R and Jetta GLI recently. So we do have touch-based temperature controls along the bottom of the screen. I really, really don't like this setup, even though I use climate control on an automatic mode. And every once in a while, I might want to adjust the temperature. I just don't like this. It's not very visible at night, and I think there's a better way to do it. Sure, the climate control menu is all built into this screen, but I just like some easier way to interface with the system with volume and climate controls. In terms of straight line acceleration, this is relatively quick. It'll do 0 to 60 in a tick over 6 seconds, which is reasonably quick to keep up with today's traffic. Certainly not as blistering quick as some EVs, but more than quick enough. And the throttle response is instantaneous, so really can't complain about that. It's about as quick as the Jetta GLI or GTI are in a straight line. Top speed's limited to 112 miles an hour, maybe, and you really don't need to be going that fast in a crossover like this. And in terms of responsiveness, what I do find is the throttle response is pretty much instantaneous and it's eager to accelerate. On top of that, I do often run this in the engine braking mode. I think, yeah, we're there now. And I find it's very, very intuitive. It's one of the better one pedal drive setups that I've driven. I think the Ford Mustang Mach-E is probably my favorite, but this is intuitive and that's the way I typically drive it in the city. On the freeway, we're just gonna set it on adaptive cruise and be happy. I don't know how they distribute torque in any of the drive modes, if they change that in any way. Really, no matter what I'm doing, torque distribution seems intuitive and natural. I suppose that's the upside of having electric motors at each axle, because their responsiveness is pretty much instant. In terms of handling, I was pleasantly surprised. This is a crossover with a taller center of gravity. Of course, the battery pack is in the floor, so for a crossover, it's got a relatively low center of gravity. And we do have conventional dampers here, so I wasn't expecting this to handle anything like a GTI or a Golf R, but surprisingly, it's enjoyable to throw through the corners. We do have conventional dampers here. There's no adaptive dampers. The dampers do a great job with body and wheel control, even over rough for roads mid-corner. I was really surprised. It's fairly well resolved with just excellent body and wheel control for a pretty much conventional suspension. And what I do think about this platform is that it forms the basis of some potentially interesting products in the future. I think they could make this much more sporting and much more interesting to drive, but as it is, it's relatively satisfying. No, it doesn't have the sportiness of a Golf R, for example, but it still remains fun to drive, and that's one of the most important factors for me. The steering's electrically assisted, as you know, but one of the things Volkswagen seems to have done is, with this EV platform, they've taken advantage of that, and it's got an incredibly short turning radius. I'm very impressed how maneuverable this is in parking situations, and that's one of the things they did, because there's not a huge engine or engine and transmission combination sitting between the front axle. It's just a small electric motor. They've taken the opportunity to give the steering a little bit more articulation, so you've got a lot of steering lock, and this is incredibly maneuverable, especially when parking. I think that's a huge benefit. We do have to talk about braking, and there's a couple of reasons for that. If you're a regular viewer of the show, you know that engineering a braking system like this that combines regenerative braking as well as a conventional braking system is a difficult thing for engineers to do. Some car companies get it perfectly, others, well, maybe need a little bit of improvement. And for the most part, I really enjoy the braking system, especially when I'm driving this on one pedal mode. But when I get into that brake pedal from time to time, that brake pedal effort I need to slow this down doesn't seem exactly linear. Now, keep in mind, I'm hypersensitive to a good brake pedal. I think most people won't even notice, but this is one of those cases where it could use a little bit refinement to at least satisfy crazy drivers like me who are highly, highly sensitive to a brake pedal. What I also like about the suspension setup is that it's very compliant. It does handle bumps quite easily, and of course you should expect a bit of body roll. This is a crossover after all, but overall ride comfort is definitely prioritized, and there's just a little bit of sporting character to the suspension setup to satisfy drivers who may drive a little enthusiastically from time to time. How do you spec yours? Well, that is the question, and you've got to delve into the trim choices to understand what kind of features you get at certain trim levels.
What you are looking at is an ID.4 Pro S all-wheel drive in Aurora Red with black and gray leatherette, and options include the black roof, the 21-inch wheels, a heat pump, and of course the Aurora Red paint is an option. In the US, this is roughly $54,270. You get a panoramic roof, but you don't get the 21s apparently. In Canada, base price is $60,495, and as tested, this is exactly $64,995, and that's before freight, taxes, and local incentives.
For me, anyway, I've been enjoying all the features and luxuries of this Pro S all-wheel drive, and I think this color works on this body shape. This is very elegant, so if I would make a recommendation, it's probably similar spec to this Pro S all-wheel drive. My verdict, well, I have to say, it's been a very pleasant week driving this ID.4. And yeah, I have a charger at home that makes life a lot easier. And of course, charging rates on overnight electricity in the city of Toronto is ridiculously inexpensive. So I may have spent maybe $12 charging this for a fair bit of driving. And that's impressive on its own. But that's really not what this is about. The question in my mind is whether Volkswagen's been able to put together a competent EV. And from my experience, this is highly usable, very, very comfortable, very well finished. It's spacious. And this one, of course, is all-wheel drive, so it makes sense for an all-year kind of crossover EV in this part of the world. But I have enjoyed my time behind the wheel. I do think Volkswagen has done a great job with this. The platform can definitely be used for some interesting things in the future. And less a couple of quibbles, I really can't complain about this ID.4 Pro S. And another thing about driving an EV, these things are whisper quiet. And in a big city like where I live, I've snuck up on people while parallel parking this thing. It is fun to drive, but in terms of this being an EV, well, what I do like about this is that it's produced and engineered by Volkswagen without shortcuts that maybe some other EV makers might choose to play with, and that's really not the case here. This is very well resolved, it's very well engineered, and certainly now on my list of recommended EV crossovers. Thanks for hanging out with me today and having a look at this 2024 Volkswagen ID.4 Pro S all-wheel drive. Hope you liked this episode, and if you did, you're not new, you know what to do. Smash the subscribe button, turn on your notifications, like this video, and as always, sharing is caring, so please share this with your friends, especially on Reddit, because on Reddit, they really need to see reviews for drivers from drivers. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them in the comments below. I'll get back to you as soon as I can. And if you want to support the channel, please hit up our merch store. Links here, links below. Lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, including our very popular line of Save the Manuals merch. Thanks again for watching. We'll see you again next time. And remember, cars don't understeer by themselves, not even Volkswagen ID.4s.